We are going to start our service in just a moment with a prelude, and our theme today is facing our struggles and trying to get through them successfully and how the Lord helps us with that. So we'll think about that as we get started this morning. So I invite the band to come forward.
Sends his pure, sweet love, a sign from above,
a sign from above,
on the wings of a dove.
Sing our first song on page 188. This is the day. This is the day.
This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. Our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, you have given us your word because it shows us how much you love us and shows us how we can love one another. Lord, open your word today in our hearts and our minds and help us to learn from you the path to heaven. Help us to put away selfishness and self-concern that's merely about us, and help us to open our hearts and our eyes and see the world around us and see those who could use our love and support. And Lord, help us to know the difference between what is good and what is hurtful, what is true and what is false, so that our lives can be shaped to be angels of heaven. Amen. Our Father, who art in the heavens, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as in heaven, so upon the earth. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. O Lord, forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Amen. We're all invited to be seated, and we're going to begin our service with a talk for the children. So, good morning, children. And if you go to the very beginning of the Lord's Word, there's these stories that are beautiful parables about our lives. And the first one is the book of creation, how the Lord created the world and how the Lord helps us to become something special too. And at the end of creation, the Lord, right after that story, there's a story of this garden that the Lord created. And he created human being to be in the garden. You've probably heard of it, called the Garden of Eden. In that garden, the Lord created all kinds of animals and fruits and vegetables and things that people could eat. And they made very clear command to the people in the garden, to Adam and Eve, as we often think of them. He said, I don't have all these trees to point to, but he said, there's all these trees in the garden, and all these trees have fruits on them that are good to eat. So we're all going to imagine that these are from the different trees in the garden that are good to eat. And the Lord said, the tree of life in the center of the garden, you may eat of that, but don't eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, which we'll refer to as this. If you eat of it, you will die. So pretty clear instructions, right, on how to work. And the Garden of Eden was a beautiful place. It was watered. They didn't have to water it. There were rivers that would just spread forth and would water the ground, and things would grow. And everything was provided for them. It was a beautiful picture of how much the Lord loves us and how the Lord provides for us. So I'm going to read you the story for you today, and then we'll talk a little bit about what happened and why they weren't in the garden for long. It says, the Lord God commanded the humans, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, has God indeed said you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said to the serpent, we may eat the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it, lest you die. Then the serpent said to the woman, you will not surely die, for God knows that in the day that you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So the woman saw, when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes, and tree desirable to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. She also gave to her husband with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves coverings. And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and the human and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. Then the Lord God called to the human and said to him, where are you? So he said, I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you that you should not eat? Then the human said, the woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I ate. And the Lord God said to the woman, what is this you have done? The woman said, the serpent deceived me, and I ate. Then the Lord God said, behold, the human has become like one of us, to know good and evil. And now, lest he put out his hand and take also of the tree of life and eat, and live forever. Therefore the Lord God sent him out of the Garden of Eden to till the ground from which he was taken. Amen. So it's pretty clear what happened in the story, isn't it? The Lord's created the garden and made a very clear choice for them. He said, you can eat all these beautiful fruits. We have a good example of them today. You can eat all of those. Have as much as you want. But don't eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. The day you eat of it, you will surely die. I purposely didn't put an apple here because there's no mention of an apple in the story. So just to be clear, it was a piece of fruit. So we're going to go with the grapefruit today. The Lord said, don't eat that. If you eat it, you'll die. So what happened? Why did they decide to not listen to the Lord anymore? Well, there was a serpent that came along. I have my special serpent. All right. It came along and said, look at that beautiful tree over there. Why don't you eat from that tree? And Eve said, no, I'm not allowed to eat from that tree. The Lord said, if I eat of it, I'll die. You won't die. In fact, you'll become like a god. You'll become even better than you were before. Really? Yeah. It looks like good fruit. I mean, it looks tasty, so maybe I'll try it. Like, yeah, go ahead, try it. So she ate of that fruit, and she gave some to her husband. And they realized something for the first time, that they were naked. Like, whoa, we're naked. And they were embarrassed that they were naked. And so the Lord came along and saw what was happening and asked what had happened. And of course, the woman said, or Adam said, well, the woman that you gave me, she gave it to me, and it's because of her. The Lord talked to her and says, well, it's because of the snake, because of this talking serpent told me to do it. And that's why I ate of it. Well, what do we learn from this story? It's pretty obvious in one simple sense that when we listen to the Lord, things go well. Because here's the end of the story, which I didn't really mention, is that they had to leave the garden. They weren't allowed to be there anymore because of what happened. They sowed fig leaves for themselves because they were embarrassed of their nakedness, and they had to go out of the garden. They had to till the soil instead of having everything provided for them. They had to work for it instead. So did they die when they ate the fruit? You might say, well, no, they didn't die, so the Lord was wrong. But they actually died as to the way of life. The way of life they had died for them. They didn't have it anymore because they didn't listen to the Lord. So what is this all about? Well, the serpent in the story, what do snakes do? They kind of crawl. They're low animals on the ground. They picture our senses, things like what we see, what we smell, what we taste, what we touch, and what we hear. And they're useful things for us, right? We don't want to get rid of them. We're very happy to have those. And they can teach us some things about life, but they don't teach us about how to be a good person or how to love the Lord. And we start listening to them instead of listening to what the Lord says. That's when we get in trouble. So let's say you're in a store and you saw a chocolate bar on the shelf. You said, oh, that looks really good. Your eyes are like, yeah, those look really good. you can have that. I bet it tastes really good too. And you might remember what chocolate tastes like. And you might think, oh, I should just take it because I want it, right? If we listened only to the serpent or to our senses, we would get in trouble because we're not supposed to steal, are we? We're not supposed to take things from the store that aren't ours that we didn't pay for. That's the kind of stuff that we're talking about. And this morning, I don't know how many of you were up for the sunrise. Did you see the sun rising this morning? Well, did it rise this morning? No, not really. I mean, it looks like it rose, right? But it didn't. The earth actually turned, and the sun stayed where it was, and we were able to see it. So there's things that our eyes and our ears and our nose and our touch tell us that are true, but they really aren't true. They're your appearances for us. So it's important to have our senses guide us in some way, but they're not going to tell us what's good and what's right. Like, we can use our sense of touch in a very healthy way, and we can also use it to push somebody or smack somebody, and that's not using it. We might think, oh, that's a good idea, but it's not, because we know, because the Lord has told us, that's not something nice to do. So we listen to the Lord who created us and gave us life, and gave them the Garden of Eden in this story with all of its goodness. Or do you listen to the snake? And you know, there's part of us that really likes what the snake is saying, because it's going to feel good, it's going to taste good, it's going to smell good, or whatever it is that we want. But we can't listen to that. We have to say, is this really what the Lord says? Because if we don't, we're going to get in trouble, just like happened in the story, okay? All right, well, we'll talk a little bit more about things like this in our next, in the adult lesson, but thank you, children, for listening. We're going to sing our next song now.
On page 154, Seek Ye First, page 154.
Bow your heads for a blessing on the children. Lord, help your children to know the difference between what you speak and what their bodies might be telling them, and to learn from you what is true and what is good, and make choices based on your wisdom. Thank you, Lord. May the Lord give his angels charge over you to keep you in all of your ways. Amen. I invite you all to be seated, and we're going to continue our service with some more readings. This is first one is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 4. And Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights afterward, he was hungry. Now when the tempter came to him, he said, "If you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread." But he answered and said, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him up into the holy city and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge over you, and in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "It is written again, you shall not tempt the Lord your God." Again, the devil took him up on an exceedingly high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, "All these things I will give to you if you will fall down and worship me." Then Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only you shall serve." Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and ministered to him. This final reading is from the Heavenly Doctrine for the New Church from Secrets of Heaven 751. During temptations or trials, it is evil spirits who stir up our falsities and evil. From our memory, they stir up everything we have ever considered or committed since childhood. Evil spirits are able to do this with such consummate skill and malice that words cannot describe it. The angels who accompany us, though, bring out the goodness and truth that we have and use it to defend us. The conflict between these parties is what we sense and feel, and it causes our conscience to gnaw at us and torment us. There are two kinds of trial, one testing the intellect and the other the will. In struggles involving our intellectual processes, evil spirits stir up only the following: the wrong we have done, for which they accuse and condemn us, our good deeds, which they twist in a thousand ways, our thoughts. A struggle of this kind is mild, and we perceive it only as the memory of such things, along with a kind of resulting anxiety. A struggle involving the urges of our will, on the other hand, does not stimulate the memory of our thoughts and deeds in this way. Rather, wicked demons, a name for evil spirits of this type, kindle in us the cravings and vile kinds of love that already permeate us, and so they attack us with our own feelings, our own longings, excuse me. This they manage so malevolently and covertly that no one could ever believe it was their doing. It takes them only a moment to infiltrate the vital energy that lies behind our longings. In almost no time, they change and redirect our desire for goodness and truth into a desire for evil and falsity. We end up totally unaware that this event did not happen on its own, that it did not unfold spontaneously. This kind of trial is very severe, and we perceive it as an excruciating, burning pain inside. Amen. Here end our lessons, and blessed are they who hear the word of God and keep it. Amen. I have finally found a way to live. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. So I want you to imagine someone who is working hard to stick to a new diet. It's hard, but she's doing pretty well. She's starting to feel pretty good about how she looks and how she feels. And she wants to do something special to celebrate. So she prepares a nice meal for her husband and cleans up the home. And then her husband comes home. He doesn't notice how nice she looks. He doesn't notice how nice the house looks. He doesn't make any comment on that. She says, well, dinner will be ready soon. And he says, well, I'm not hungry. I grabbed a burger on the way home. And he says, I'm tired too, and I think I'm just going to go watch some TV and go to bed. What will happen to her emotional state in that situation? Let's not answer that question quite yet. Picture a young man trying to create a better relationship with his father. His father is often critical of him and his choices that he makes, and it's hard work for him, for the son, to spend time with his father. He's working hard on his issues, and the buttons get pushed when they communicate, when they see each other. But he's resolved to rise above it. He's working on it. He goes over after a few weeks to visit his father. He's feeling strong and confident, and he knocks on the door, and the first thing the father says is, well, it's about time you made an effort to come and visit. Look how dirty your car is. Don't you have any self-respect? So what will happen to his emotional state? Well, we go through things like this all the time, don't we? And it could be an example. There's lots of different examples we could use, certainly. But there are examples when we face an internal struggle. We're trying to do something right. We're trying to be different. And then we're faced with opposition to our resolve, and our efforts to grow are harmed. So what do we do when we're faced with those kinds of struggles? What's going on inside of us, and how can we stay on track and not be hijacked by negative emotions or behaviors or fall back to maybe where we had been? You can imagine in that first example of one woman just wanting to give up, like, what's the point? Maybe hitting those old comfort snacks hard and feeling demoralized, like, why am I trying? Or that young man looking for approval somewhere else, maybe in a damaging way because he doesn't feel valued. But of course, this is not what has to happen. There are options, of course. You can try to push through the struggle, push through the pain of it, and keep doing the right thing. But how? How do we do that? Well, we're in church, so you probably expect this answer, is that we really need to build a living relationship with the Lord and to take it seriously in our lives, because we aren't capable of our own strength to rise above these sorts of things without the Lord's help. We must enlist the help of the Lord our God, because we're powerless. I want to share this passage from Doctrine of Charity 203, and just listen to what it says. It says, one who believes in God says to themselves, with God's help, I can overcome it. And so they make supplication, which means they pray, they ask for help. And they get help. This is not denied to anyone, but is given because the Lord, from his divine love, is in the continual endeavor to reform and to regenerate us, and so to purify us from our evils. And this constant endeavor of the Lord comes into effect when we truly desire it and make an effort for it. In this and no other way do we receive the power to resist evils and to fight against them. So there's a lot of things in that passage. There's a lot of notable things to touch on. If we ask for help, it says help comes. That's what the Lord wants to do all the time, just waiting for an invitation to be invited in. And we need to truly desire it. We need to want it to happen. And not just that, but we have to make an effort for it. So you have to want it and you have to try. And it says this is the only way that we have power to overcome these things. But how often do we only desire the help when our lives have sort of bottomed out? We feel like we've hit our low and like, okay, I'm going to call on the Lord because I can't do this. And not a regular part of our life. It's not like our daily medicine, our daily routine. We only want the help when we want to get out of a jam. Or how often do we make a half-hearted attempt and then give in and pray for forgiveness later? Like, well, that's not, not going to make it, so I'll ask. The Lord's loving, he'll forgive me, and I'll ask for help. So kind of a cycle that of dysfunction we can get involved in is sometimes we choose maybe a meager attempt, or maybe we just only pray and think that's going to do it, and then we give in, and then we ask for forgiveness, and it goes over and over. Instead, we need to ask for the desire, or we have to ask for the want to. Lord, help me to want to be a good person. Help me to want what's right in this situation. And I pray for the ability to actually make an effort. And I think it's important to think about both of those. Ask me to want this. Lord, help me to want this and help me to make an effort for it. Notice this teaching from the Heavenly Doctrine. It says, the smallest amount of divine power is enough. Every time it is called on to tame instantly the entire devil's crew, even if it consisted of millions. Sounds pretty strong. Like just a little bit of divine power. If we call upon it every time, it's enough to overcome. Even if you're fighting against millions of evil spirits, it's enough. So the help is there, and it's more than enough to do the job. Any issue that we might have, that we might be struggling with, because of the Lord and his love for us and the work that he accomplished in his life in this world, he fought against the entirety of the hells of his own strength and all of their fury. So there's nothing too big, nothing too difficult that the Lord can't do for us. But we have to want it, and we have to ask for it, and we have to act on it. So this leads into the idea of struggles and temptations, of course. And what are temptations? Well, they're an attack of some kind of love that we have inside of ourselves. It's always, they always attack something we care about. And so what happens when we're in a state of temptation is the end goal or what we desire is put in doubt. And it's hard to overcome when what we are fighting for, it feels like this isn't going to happen. So the Lord gives us a lot of different imagery in the Word to help us to see or to sort of describe what temptations are like or what we might be going through. So you picture Noah and the ark being on this ark in the flood waters and the flood inundating the land and sort of being locked in this ark, sort of powerless. And that's a good picture of temptations too, where things are just flooding our minds, falsities are flooding our thinking, and we feel like we can't do anything. Or Jacob, when he was going to see his brother Esau after their long separation, he wrestled, it says, with an angel there on the way to see him. This sort of wrestling that we do, this sort of bouts. I don't know if any of you wrestled in your life, but it's a struggle, right? And it's hard work. It's more exhausting than you can imagine. These three two-minute things are like, why is that so hard? I'm only doing 6 minutes of work. Or the children of Israel in the wilderness, they're wandering and they're thirsty and they're hungry and they're fighting enemies. All of those things picture the kind of things that we are experiencing in temptation. Or Daniel in the lion's den, this total, I'm powerless, I'm in this den surrounded by hungry lions that want to tear me apart. Or Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace, this feeling like we have no strength, no ability to overcome, or that's the appearance, of course. And those are a few examples of what it might feel like for us internally. And then, of course, Jesus being baptized and then going into the wilderness and is tempted by the devil. And he's tempted for 40 days and for 40 nights, which number 40 always pictures a state of temptation or trial. And notice in the story of the Lord there that he's baptized and then he enters the wilderness in temptations. It kind of follows that when we try to do what's good, like the baptism in this story, we try to connect with our higher self, try to do the right thing, that we are then tempted. We try to make a choice for good, and then the battles show up. We're confronted. And what we're doing, or what happens, is we're tempted to give up the long-term plan and take immediate gratification. Like the temptation, the first temptation that the devil offered was, and Jesus had been fasting for 40 days, or he's been in the wilderness, he hadn't eaten for 40 days, and the devil says, why don't you turn those stones into bread? I think that's a really good temptation, right? Something, I'm starving, I'm hungry, I could do this, right? That would satisfy it, this short-term gratification, instead of, no, I have a bigger plan than that. So why does that hook us, that temptation to give up? Well, because all evil has delight attached to it. But we need to remember, too, that all evil has misery attached to it. So there is a delight, but there's also a pain that follows. And that's something that always occurs. And I don't know if you're struggling with a particular thing in your life, which you've battled with it over and over again, and you probably have enough data based on your experience to go, well, if I go down this path, it won't end well for me. I know that. I've been there a lot of times, and I know it doesn't end well. Yeah, but maybe you won't die. You'll be fine, right? There's that temptation to feel like it's going to be okay this time. But we know that. We know enough data to know that's not going to end well. It always leads that way. So here's a passage that I wanted to share with you. It says that all evils are innately delightful. And people might wonder, why do I get involved in bad behavior? It's stupid, right? Why would I do that? Well, because it's delightful. There's a delight attached to it. So all evils are innately delightful because we are born into the love of self. And that love makes all things delightful that are of our own. Thus, whatever we will and whatever we think, and everyone remains till death in the delights that are enrooted by birth, unless they are subdued, and they are not subdued unless they are regarded as sweet drugs that kill, or as flowers apparently beautiful that carry poison in them. Thus, unless the delights of evil are regarded as deadly, and this until at length they become undelightful. Now notice that sweet flowers or sweet drugs that kill are flowers that look beautiful, but they have poison in them. We need to recognize, hey, it looks nice, that looks fine, looks delightful, but it carries with it something painful. So we need to have that perspective. And the writings say this about evils that we're drawn to. You know, when you see something that, or you're drawn to something that you want to engage in that you know you ought not to, it says, here's a simple way to handle that, is to say, although I am thinking this and intending it, like, I want this. You sort of acknowledge that, yeah, I'm into this, but I'm not going to do it. Although I'm thinking it and intending it, I will not do it because it's a sin against the Lord. That's what the writings call the easier kind of repentance. Say, yep, I really want it, but I'm not going to do it because it's against the Lord's will for me. So we can be drawn into all kinds of things that are hurtful to us. Like, it feels good to win an argument, doesn't it? Like, that's great. I won. I'm right. You're wrong. But at the end of that, it really doesn't feel good. After a little while, you start to feel like, I wish I hadn't been so stubborn, or I wish I hadn't been so pervasive, so interested in my own agenda and just been more open-minded and open-hearted. And that's the regret that comes, right? Or it feels good to get our kids to obey us, right? Say, I'm the adult here. You will do what I say. And we rule over them. And maybe act in ways that we shouldn't, more strong-handed than we should be. And it's like, that feels good. Yep, I'm the boss. Sort of feel a little puffed up. But then comes the shame and regret and pain of knowing I could have handled that differently and this would have been better for them. But much better for them if I had handled it in a different way. Or the story of the prodigal son, of course, the classic example of partying and going off and wasting all what we have on prodigal living and being reckless and self-indulgent. But as the story illustrates, then the shame and hurt comes after that, the loneliness and shame, and realizing I've got to do something different, heal. So what are the temptations? Well, the writings say they're nothing else than combats against the hells. So that's what we're experiencing. We're fighting against hell. And it's a war waged to win our heart and our mind over to their side. A temptation is a battle between the two. The hell wants us, and heaven would like us to be free and happy. So they're fighting on our behalf. And they assault the things that we love. And you might ask, well, why do they do that? Why do evil spirits do that? Well, they hate us. They hate all that's good. They hate what's innocent. And you might think, that's ridiculous. Why would they do that? It's what they love. And why me? Am I special? No. They hate everybody equally. So don't have to feel special about it. Just know that they're after you, and they hit the campaign trail hard, trying to trip us up to bring misery into our life, prevent us from finding a place of happiness and good. So Jesus being tempted in the wilderness, the things that he was tempted about illustrate the things we fight against, turning stones to bread, again, departing from our mission or purpose, giving up what we know is good or right for what is maybe easier, satisfies a short-term desire. Or going up on the temple and saying, cast yourself down Some, the angels will rescue you, that kind of thing, and that temptation to fight against the love of self. This idea, well, I can do anything and I'll be fine, or everyone exists to serve me. That's not true. You shall not tempt the Lord your God. You shall not go with that agenda. Don't make yourself more important in that sense than we need to be. Then going on a high mountain and bow yourself before me. I'll give you all the kingdoms of the world. And that's a, we have to fight against that desire to make things of the world stuff much more important than anything else. And the willingness to break commandments or do things that are unhealthy or dysfunctional to get them. So we throw our effort toward integrity away and attempt to achieve something good. So what do the hells do? Well, they do two things. They attack our intellect. They bring up all the wrong things we've ever done, for which they accuse and condemn us. I'm sure you heard that in the passage. It's pretty hard. They take these things we've done and they accuse us and condemn us. You wonder, where did that come from? They just brought it up for you. Just a little gift. Let me remind you of the faults you have, the mistakes you've made, and you won't be able to do the right thing. And they condemn us, and they twist things around in 1,000 different ways. And that's why it's important to study the Word, because the Word tells us that they do this and that it's not from me. I may have done those things, but the Lord may have forgiven me for them and I may have been forgiven of them, but they want us to remind us that we're still bad and they want us to feel guilty about it. Know that this is not you. It's flowing into you. They want you to give up trying. Another thing they do is they attack the will. They try to change and redirect our desire for goodness and truth and a desire for what's evil and false. So you might have this good intention and they just want to redirect it towards something self-seeking or hurtful, which is just plain mean, right? But that's what they do. So I talked about why they attack us, and I think about the Adam and Eve story and the serpent, and you think, well, what's in it for the serpent? What's he going to get out of it? Well, if you think of it as an example of the influence of hell in our life, is that nothing. They just don't like us. They just like to hurt, like to cause trouble. So the thing about temptations is, and this is what the serpent does in the story, is it makes things that are self-seeking seem really alluring. They make it seem like things of our senses are much more important than things that are lasting, things that are of heaven. It always seems great. Like they lie and deceive in order to make it that way. It tempts us when we're weak. It tempts us as soon as we make progress. Or it tempts us with something that we care about or that's important to us. So how do we defend ourselves against these kinds of attacks? Well, here's what the writings say. Is the angels who accompany us, though, while the evil spirits are doing this, they bring out the goodness and truth that we have, and they use it to defend us. So you hear that, and you go, well, you have to have some goodness and truth in order for them to draw out. And that's why I harp on us over and over again to fill our minds with truth and do what's good, because that's the ammunition that the angels can use to fight against the power of the hells. What did Jesus do in each of those temptations? He pulled the truth out and he quoted it back to them. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. I had an interesting experience the other day where, I don't know if you've had this experience, where you feel the warm rush of hell entering you, like wants to do something wrong, and it's like, I felt it like this warm, it's like, feels good yet scary. Wow, that's frightening. And I just sat with it and said, quote of scripture, like, I don't remember what I said, but, and then it sort of flush feeling went away. I was like, wow, okay, cool. The thing I keep saying to you is true, at least based on my experience. So what are the truths that we have that we're equipped with that can help us in those situations when that is happening? Because when that rush comes in, when that hellish influence comes in, it feels like I have no choice. But breathe and notice I have a choice. And I can, in that space, we have a moment where we can say something, we can invite the Lord in, we can invite Scripture into our minds, say it out loud if we have to. It says, the hells have no power against divine truth proceeding from the Lord or against any person in whom there is divine truth from the Lord. So what can we do? Well, lots of people start new diets and new exercise regimens without giving any thought to a new diet for their mind and for their spirit, right? We get very focused on this chunk of flesh, but we forget about the part that's going to be with us forever. This body is temporal, it's short-term. So I invite you, I encourage you, I plead with you, short of begging of you, to start a new diet for your mind, which is rich with divine truth. And like dieting, remember, dieting isn't just about what you put in your body, but what you will not put in your body, what you won't take in. I think of the hellish influences in our life, the falsities, the things that we're drawn to. Think of it as media pollution, perhaps, as the stuff that clouds our perspective. So if I'm trying to see something good in the future that I want to strive for, what's all the garbage in the way that's clouding my thinking? What am I feeding my mind with that's messing with that perspective? What's the clutter in there? Get rid of that clutter. Don't feed yourself on that stuff. And like with a program of exercise, you have to practice it. Practice and do it. It will help us with the floods of negativity that come up, the apathy, the desire to give up, and so forth, because the Lord is the Word. And when the Lord is present, He can help us to fight against those things we're fighting against. Now, I'm not asking you to get a doctorate in theology or anything like that. I'm just asking you to spend a few minutes a day reading the Word, reading something that's true, 10 minutes at the most. Well, read as much as you want, but do at least 10 minutes. Or 5 minutes. 5 minutes might be enough. The writings say this, that the smallest amount of divine truth is enough every time. The smallest amount is enough every time. And it says, this is not denied to anyone, but is given to you when you truly desire it and make an effort for it. Again, ask for the wanting and then make the effort. You'll never be perfect at it, but if you don't try, you won't get anywhere either. When we try, something happens. The psalmist says, Lord, you have brought light to my life. My God, you light up my darkness. In your strength, I can crush an army. With my God, I can scale any wall. For who is God except the Lord? Who but our God is a solid rock? God arms me with strength. He has made my way safe. Amen. We bow our heads for our prayer for a moment. Lord, we pray that you arm us with the strength and power of your word. Help us not to forget to begin our days with some time with you, just a small amount of time connecting with you and your word. And help us to call upon you and ask for what it is that we want, who it is we want to become, the things we want to give up, things we want to take on and change into. And help us to make effort. Without effort and without you, we will not make it. Thank you, Lord, for the promise of your strength and how much you love us and how much you're fighting for us every moment. Amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. I invite you to stand for the closing of the word.
We'll close with our final song on page 206, You Are the Way, page 206. There's a life that is a lot of love.
close with a postlude, which we hope you will enjoy.
How fickle my heart and how woozy my eyes. I struggle to find any truth in your lies. And now my heart stumbles on things I don't know. My weakness I feel I must finally show. Lend me your hand and we'll conquer them all. But lend me your heart and I'll just let you fall. Lend me your eyes, I can change what you see. But your soul you must keep totally free. Our heart, our heart, our heart, our heart. Awake, my soul. Awake, my soul. How fickle my heart and how woozy my eyes. I struggle to find any truth in your lies. And now my heart stumbles on things I don't know. My weakness I feel I must finally show. Our heart, our heart, our heart, our heart. In these bodies we will live. In these bodies we will die. Where you invest your love, you invest your life. In these bodies we will live. In these bodies we will die. And when you invest your love, you invest your life.
For being here with us today and being with us online. And I have some time if you have any questions or comments. We have a mic in the back if you want to share anything. Otherwise, we will let you go. Great. There you go.
So it it's taken 26 years, and I finally get what you're saying. So, just the reading of the word and having having the little pieces in your head that you can draw on when you need it, it's so important because, yeah, I have the thing where they'll just come in and bang, they're on me.
Yep.
And sometimes it feels like there's nothing I can do. And I'm just starting to get the idea that, you know, it's all about the heart and the lungs, the will and the understanding, you know, truth and good. And it's like, I can't really change how I feel about something, but I can change how I think about it. So I can change how I breathe, but I can't change my heart rate necessarily. But if I change my breathing, it does affect my heart rate.
Right.
So if I change what I'm thinking about, it changes how I feel about things. So, and it's all that, it's the whole thing. It's all there, dude. It's all there. So, yeah, thank you. I finally get it. I get it.
Cool. Thank you, Greg. It takes a while sometimes. Gail, I don't think that mic's quite on yet, so if you want to turn it on for somebody. Just hold it till it turns blue. Good?
Hello.
Right.
Okay. So I think, if I didn't dream it, sometime before Easter, you challenged everybody to read the word.
Yeah.
And to read, I don't know, I can't remember if it was the book of Matthew or something before Easter, or to read every day for 2 weeks. And I thought there was a bribe involved.
There was.
Chocolate. Did you ever circle back around on that?
Well, I'll tell you that I sent out 2 chocolate bars, so that's the results I got is 2 people that did it. So if you want to add yourself to the list and just tell me
and
when
I kept going. Like, I'm almost through the whole New Testament, so it's like.
All right. So if you want to let me know when you did it.
Yeah. Finally. Right. After a lifetime of your preaching. Thank you.
Sure. Well, good. Anybody else can sign on too, and I send them if you're watching online and you live somewhere far, far away, that's fine. But just let me know you did it. Anything else? Peter?
I loved what Greg said, and the writings are so great about saying, you're not to blame for your feelings, they come in from hell. But where do you have control? What you choose to think about. That's where you're free, and it can take away those feelings.
Yeah. Thank you. Very good. Anything else? Nice to have some discussion. Thank you. Appreciate it. All right. Be free. David Lindruth, one of the bishops of our church, is going to be here next weekend, so he'll be preaching. I'll still be here, but he's coming out, and we have the ability to hear from him, so I hope you'll be here, and we'll see you all there. All right. Thank you.